Your Omaha High is being sponsored by Best Buy Signs, creator of the Omaha Parks Program, OmahaFastFoods.com, Kohl's Pharmacy and Home Care, Certified Transmission, Centris Federal Credit Union, Shouldit, Rotella's Italian Bakery, La Peeps Restaurant, Performance Auto Group, Two Men and a Truck, Crane Landscape Construction, Shout Weekly, Mid-America Speakers Bureau, Farm Bureau Financial Services, Critter Control. Welcome to Your Omaha High with Andy Greenberg, the show that will leave you feeling great about yourself, Omaha's heroes, and Omaha, where we live, work, and play. So park yourself on the bench and have fun. Hi, and welcome to Your Omaha High with Andy Greenberg, the show that you turn into each and every Saturday morning because it's a feel-good show. A feel-good show about the viewer, a feel-good show about a great organization here in Omaha, Nebraska, who does some terrific things as a nonprofit, and each and every week we get to meet someone who has done some extraordinary things, either for themselves, the city of Omaha, or an organization. And you know what? I can't think of an individual who's done more for this city, more for another city that we'll talk about a little bit later, than our great featured guest of the day, Mr. Martie Cordaro, who is the general manager and president of the Omaha Storm Chasers.
Andy,
Martie, on behalf of my viewers, I'm thrilled to have you here.
Very excited.
We'll get back to Martie in a few moments. And as you know, one of the things that we do each and every week, we introduce you to four different new motivational ideas and new motivational vignettes. So let's get started. By the way, what time do you have? Could you take a look at your watch right now and tell me the time? Even if you don't have a watch with you, maybe you can look on the digital part of your cable network, or maybe you can look at a clock in your room. But somehow, I want you to tell me the time. It's probably a little bit after 10. Now, one of the things that we want to remember and recognize is that on the face of that clock, how many numbers are there? A total of 12. That's it. There are 12 numbers on every clock, 12 numbers on every watch. But isn't it interesting? If you go to the jeweler, if you go to the internet, if you pick up a magazine because you're shopping for watches or you're interested in watches, you've got to ask yourself this question. How many different designs of watches are there in this world? I want you to really think about it. There's literally hundreds of thousands of different ways to show you the time, all with the same 12 numbers. And by the way, once you get past that, there's a whole bunch of different mechanisms to get that watch to work. There is batteries, there's mechanical, there's solar, it's on your iPhone. There are so many different ways to do it. And once you get past that, how about the bands? There are so many different wristbands, all from 12 numbers. Do you see what you can do with just one set of things? Do you see how you can expand it? Do you see how you can make it more valuable? Do you see how you can open up so many different opportunities? Well, I want you to look at yourself as a watch. Yeah, just you. You're the watch. You're the individual that has got so many different things to it. But I guarantee you, you probably put yourself in a silo. You probably put yourself just as, hey, you know, it's just me. But if you begin, and when you begin, to think of yourself as a watch, and you begin to think of all the different things that you can do with your personality, all the different things that you can do with your skills, with your talents, and then how you dress it up, meaning the watch band, and then how you power it, meaning your nutrition, can you imagine the wonderful life that you would have? You would be the same person doing so many different things, satisfying so many different goals and objectives, and making so many other people happy. So the next time you look at a watch, next time you look at a wristband, the next time you look at what powers that watch, I want you to think of yourself. And then I want you to tell the world, watch out, here I come, I am different today. Now, we're going to have Martie talk to us a little bit later about baseball. But I want you to think about a baseball stadium, a soccer stadium, a football stadium, a tennis stadium, and even where we play basketball. And ask yourself this question. What is the difference between a baseball stadium and all those other sports arenas that we just talked about? Just take a moment and think about it. because the answer might not be as obvious as you think. Are you ready? All the other sports have predefined sizes. The basketball court, the football court, the soccer court, the tennis court, every one of those are designed around a particular parameter of size that the person who invented that particular sport declared had to be. Baseball stadiums, they're different. Every one of the center field lengths are different. The right field length is different. The height of the gate is different. The height of the fence is different, although the space between the bases are the same, I'll grant you that. But everything else is different. It is unique. That's one of the things that makes baseball different. It's called variety. It's not necessarily the same. Now, why do I bring this to your attention? Because it shows you what you can slash should do with something that you think must have borders, with something you think that must always conform to what other people say it should be. And by the way, you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, you. Because sometimes you put yourself in a box, sometimes you put yourself in a parameter, sometimes you put yourself in a life situation where you say to yourself, the only thing I have to do is fit in, the only thing I have to do is conform, the only thing I have to do is be exactly the same as everybody else. Well, you don't. Because what I want you to think about is you as a baseball field, you expanding the length, you changing things up and being different than anybody else who plays in the same field as you. Now, you know how many times when you read a book, an instructional book, you have that yellow marker. And what do we normally do? We highlight something, especially if we're studying, we highlight something that we think is very important to us, something we like, something we can relate to, something that we can become attached to. And that's the purpose of the yellow highlight. And the key word here is highlighting. So I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to sit back for a moment, and I want you to open up your autobiography. Now, you might not have written it yet, but it's certainly in your head. You know everything that happened in your life. And I want you to think about five things, just five, that are the highlights of your life. Got it? Now, when you began to think of that, did you focus on any negatives? Did you focus on a negative highlight? Or did you do what really should have been done and take that yellow marker and highlight all the great things that have happened to you, all the great things that you allowed to have happened to you? That's the purpose of the highlighting. That's the purpose of the yellow highlighting. That's the purpose of you reviewing your autobiography. That's the purpose of you reviewing your life. When you write a book about yourself, do you really want to put the bad stuff in there? Well, you have to for some realism. But you want to be able to focus on all the positive things. So when you wake up in the morning, when you go to sleep at night, when you think about yourself, when you're in that period of meditation or self-reflection, think about your autobiography and always highlight everything that's positive. And of course, I've got to ask you this question. Everybody looks for satisfaction in their life. Satisfaction. I want to be satisfied. Is something satisfactory about what I want to do? Did you ever take the word satisfaction and break it apart and understand its components? Well, the first part is easy. If you take the status aside, what word are you left with? Action. Now, you're then left with the other word, status. And I actually looked it up. You know what status means? Enough. In order for you and anybody to get full satisfaction, you just have to take enough action to get it done. And the moment you take that action, and enough of it to make sure that you achieve what you want, guess what? You've achieved total life satisfaction. So today, here's what you learned. You learned about watches. You learned about baseball stadiums. You learned about highlighting all the positive things about your life. And you learned about satisfaction and how to get it. And again, that's getting enough action. Now, each and every week, we always profile a nonprofit organization. And this week, I am thrilled to tell you about Impact One. Impact One is breaking the silence of violence and poverty right here in Omaha, Nebraska, by creating opportunities for young people to lead productive lives in our community. Impact One assists at-risk and disengaged youth and young adults to become positive and contributing members of our community by creating a transformational relationship with the youth that still instills hope. How do they do it? Through mentoring, education, spiritual development, and job skill development. Impact One focuses on partnering, I should say, with community agencies, organizations, and systems to promote the success of these individuals. Impact One does this by engagement in school outreach, street outreach, game changers, re-entry, emergency response, and summer jobs. The goal is young people living free of violence and poverty, and we need that in this city and throughout the United States and world. The ultimate goal is to end the cycle of violence and poverty in the generations to come. For more information, please visit www.impactoneomaha.com or Impact One Omaha on their Facebook page. Impact One, doing great things for a wonderful city. And you talk about an individual, a group, an organization who are doing and continue to do and show a history of doing great things for the city. You can only mention one team right here, and that is the Omaha Storm Chasers. I am so pleased to introduce you to the general manager and president of the Omaha Storm Chasers, none other than Martie Cordaro. Martie, thanks so much for being here today.
Andy, thanks.
And
it's a pleasure.
And the organization for doing so much for baseball, so much for Omaha, and so much, as we'll learn in a few moments, for the city of Kansas. But I want to learn more about you. How and when did you get involved in organized sports?
I started playing baseball when I was 4 or 5 years old, started playing t-ball and played all through high school. So played a number of other sports, but baseball was always my passion, if you will.
And how were you in 4 or 5 years? Do you remember that t-ball?
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
Pretty bad?
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
But
yeah,
it never
absolutely
stopped you?
No, it didn't. So. You know, I was, even through high school, great fielder, great base runner,
sure,
great bunter.
Uh-huh.
That's not so much of a great hitter. But baseball is it's a great team sport. It's a sport that really preaches patience and teaches patience. And,
wow.
Learned a lot through it throughout the years. And I was going to be a coach, and then through some life changes, ended up getting a marketing degree and getting into professional baseball.
Getting into professional baseball. So even when you were in high school and you knew you weren't that good, it didn't stop you from playing.
Absolutely not.
It didn't stop you from making the team.
No, because it's, sports, I feel, are about the joy of playing, being with other people. Even as a spectator, going and enjoying a game, it's not all about wins and losses, even
right,
though it's pretty important,
sure,
especially
sure
at the professional level. But yeah, it's also about camaraderie and teamwork.
And as individuals, if we try something and we fail, and we're not that good at it, how many of us walk away from it? Well, a lot of us. As a matter of fact, too many. But when we hear from Marty, that's probably what has driven him and his team to be as successful as they are. It's that don't give up attitude. It's that let's go in there and do it for the team. I'm just one of the team players and team members. So you mentioned earlier, Marty, about being a coach. Now, did you have a mentor, someone that really helped you out in developing either the coaching or managerial style that you have?
There were some mentors growing up from a standpoint of, teaching a young guy who really didn't know anything. But really my main mentor, I guess, in my professional career now, what I'm doing, would be Alan Stein. He's someone over the last eight and a half years that I've really gotten to know, whether it's father figure, brother, whatever it might be. It just hasn't been the business side. It's also the personal side, and I tell people a lot, and I do a lot of speaking to colleges and high schools, when you find a mentor, make sure it's not just about, the topic at hand. Make
right
sure there are some personal elements to it as well.
And define the personal elements.
Well, it's just, bringing out what's best and having a mentor that's also not afraid to point out what's best or to be honest with you and tell you need to work on something. Here's something that may be a challenge to you. And, we always talk about strengths and challenges
right
at the Omaha Storm Chasers, not necessarily strengths and weaknesses,
right,
because challenges can definitely be overcome.
And when you overcome a challenge, that is what makes you a stronger individual. Because I've got to ask you, would you really want to go through life without challenges? Probably not, because they do make you stronger. So your first managerial job?
My first managerial job in baseball would have been managing the sales department for the AA team for the Chicago Cubs. And that was my second year in minor league baseball. And that was year 2000, my
right
second year. And then my first general manager's job would have been in Battle Creek, Michigan. That was Class A for the Tampa Bay Devil Rays. That was the Southwest Michigan Devil Rays. And that would have been in 2005.
Right.
And then I moved to Omaha as assistant general manager in 2007, and then I took over as general manager in 2008.
So I want you to listen to this very carefully. 2008, he took over as general manager. And let's take a look at his record over the past 4 years. But I'm not going to talk about it. Marty, what's your record over the past 4 years as general manager?
Well, you know, it's in minor league baseball, affiliated baseball, you have player development contracts,
right,
which means you have a relationship with a major league club.
Right.
Ours is with Kansas City. So I can't, as we've talked off camera, I can't take credit for the baseball being played per se. But, you know, the last 5 years, we've seen just tremendous baseball here in the metro area. We missed the playoffs by one game, the final year at Rosenblatt. And then the first 4 years at Warner Park, we've made the playoffs all 4 years. We've reached the Pacific Coast League title series all 4 years. Just one of two teams to do it in the last 111 years. And we've won the Pacific Coast League title 3 out of those 4 years, losing in 12 only. And then this past 2 years, we went on to win the national title back-to-back years, 2013 and 14. So it's just been, it's been remarkable. But what's even better, when you get to watch the players that have played for us, to be able to see them realize their dream and go on to play Major League Baseball is really, that's where it's at for me when it comes to the baseball side of what we do.
Now, all of that is exciting, and there are some very few people that can actually have that kind of a record. But if you know somebody, here's probably one thing they have in common. They probably have the same team. They probably have the same players. They probably have the same managers and coaches. But in this particular case, because it's minor league, what has absolutely got me amazed and quite frankly in awe, Marty, how do you do it with a different team basically every year, and this year with a brand new manager, because the manager that you had is now an exemplary coach down in Kansas City?
Absolutely.
How do you do that?
No, it's amazing. A lot of it has to do with the players and talent that Kansas City puts out. But what we try to do in our front office, since we don't specifically deal with baseball, we try to give them the best environment, whether it's through the clubhouse and the clubhouse attendants, whether it's through the turf manager and his assistants that help make the field pristine and safe and, you know, whatever, whatever they want out on the field. And then also from the standpoint of off the field and not in the clubhouse, and that has to do with promotions and marketing, community relations, and all the different endeavors and sales activities that we do. And, you know, we've had a lot of turnover on that end as well.
Yeah.
I've lost three assistant GMs just in the last 2 years. And, you know, it's about developing young and new talent. So we do that internally on the business side.
Right.
And then Kansas City also does that through their farm system as well with players. And, you know, I think a lot of it is just about philosophy. You know, it's about looking for character as well as talent, not just talent first. And I think a lot of times, you know, we as leaders will overlook that and say, okay, give me the most experienced or give me the most talented person, not also what are his character credentials? Does he like to be a part of the community? Does she like to be a part of the community? Do they like to give back? Is it just about them being on the field, or do they sign autographs after games?
Sure.
And, you know, if you come out to Warner Park and you watch an Omaha Storm Chasers game, you're going to see the top talent in the state from a sports perspective. But you're also going to see a lot of young men that will stay and sign autographs for kids or for old kids like us after games as well.
I think there's one word that might define everything that you talked about. If I was to summarize and use the word culture, there's a winning culture, there's a community culture. How would you respond to that word?
Absolutely. You know, Dayton Moore, the GM in Kansas City, took over in the summer of 2006.
Right.
And he talked about changing the culture. I would even argue that it was instilling a culture. We went through some of that same thing here in fall of 2007 when I was fortunate to be named GM. It was about instilling a culture. And, you know, we talked about becoming relevant in the metro area. For a number of years, this team had focused on, we need a new ballpark. We need a new ballpark.
Yep.
They weren't really focused on what are we doing to give back to the community. And I did a very simple, took a very simple poll. We had around a dozen full-time employees, and I said, send me an email. Tell me what community organizations you're involved in. I don't want to know what we are involved in as an organization. I can go read that and see those numbers, but what are you involved in? And we were involved in about 15 community organizations, which is, you know, a little over one per person. We're proud to say today, with our 24 full-time employees, we're involved in about 60 organizations. And that those are things that our staff are involved in, whether you're involved with your church, coaching Little League baseball, you know, working with a local soup kitchen, right, or just, you know, a local health or social charity, because I really want our staff to be passionate not only about what we do day by day, but also about this community, because at the end of the day, we work at a ballpark. It's fun. It's a fun environment.
It is.
And we want to transpire that into the community.
And it also sounds a little bit like the Ben and Jerry philosophy, where everybody has to give back to the community, both in time and also in money.
Absolutely.
Let me ask you this question. The Kansas City Royals, what a wonderful run.
Wow.
Just fantastic. That's got to make you feel a sense of pride, sense of accomplishment, a sense of involvement, and I'm even going to use the word job satisfaction.
All of the above. You know, to see their World Series run, you know, was truly amazing, and what Dayton Moore and his staff has done is, you know, on the opposite end is what we've tried to do here on the business side and in the community here, and, you know, to be the longest-running AAA partner of any team, of the 30 AAA teams here in the country.
Sure.
You know, we're proud. 1969, it was the first year of our franchise here in Omaha.
And, remember that?
You know, we plan on being associated and affiliated with Kansas City forever, you know.
And I think the thing that's remarkable is the notoriety that Omaha, Nebraska is getting and the Omaha Storm Chasers. Why? Because during that World Series run, how often had the announcers, national announcers, the newspapers say, these guys are homegrown. These guys came right here in Omaha, Nebraska. These guys came through the culture that Marty and his team built. And I still find it amazing that when somebody goes from single A to double A to triple A right here in Omaha, almost instantaneously, they adopt to the culture that you and your team, many members of a different team, have established. That's magnificent leadership. What advice can you give to a business leader and a personal leader? What I mean by personal leader, an individual who wants to grow. What advice can you give them to have a great culture and great internal and external leadership?
Well, personally, I kind of live on two things.
Okay.
One, you outwork everyone. Because you can control how hard you work and how hard you effort something. You may not be the smartest, you may not be the best looking, you may not have the most money, you may not have the most advantages, but you can out-effort and outwork someone. The other is always be honest. And tell your client, tell your friend, tell whomever you're working with what they need to hear, not what they want to hear. And I think over time, if you do that, you're going to develop a real trust.
Right.
And a real respect. So when you speak, someone's going to at least, they may not like what you're saying, but they're at least going to believe you. And I think if you do that, I think if you do those two things, I think you can overcome a lot. Now, as far as giving advice to someone, I think you need to find what are your two or three or four passions. You know, what are you most passionate about? You know, is it sales? Is it is it young talent?
Right.
You know, is it being honest?
Right.
You know, is it being ethical? Whatever the correct phrases and terms are in your industry, but you need to find them. I think you need to have two or three, three or four core things. If you have eight or nine, you're not going to focus.
You got to focus on
it. You got to focus. And so, you know, for me, outworking and out honesty.
So let's go ahead and personalize it for you. What motivates you?
For me, it's being able to walk around the ballpark and see a family, see a son, see a grandfather, and someone just having fun. You know, we're in the memory-making business. We don't control baseball. We don't control the weather.
What a great way to look at it.
So we're in the memory-making business.
Right.
And if, you know, if someone can come to our house, and that's what we look at it as our house, and they can put their job aside, they can put their problems from the standpoint of their life, any challenges they may have with their family, if they can kind of put them aside for 3 hours, 2.5 hours, and take a 9-inning vacation, then we've done our job.
Right.
If the baseball's great, that's a bonus.
Right.
You know, if the promotion's great, it's a bonus. But, you know, we control, you know, how hot a hot dog is or how cold a beer is.
Right.
You know, and that for us is really where it's at.
Sure.
And then just boil it down to making memories, helping create memories.
And talking about memories, your own personal memories, and I'm going to go out to the future now. Where do you see yourself in what you do, let's say 5 years from now, and this is not a job interview, but what are your goals? What else do you want to achieve? Because eventually, all good things have to come to an end. Eventually, the Storm Chasers, well, they're going to go on a losing streak. It has to happen unless you've got that unbelievable magic touch, which I know you do.
Well,
but what about your future? What's in it for you?
Well, I hope it doesn't end.
Yeah.
Whether I'm here or not, I hope it doesn't end.
Okay.
You know, I would like to get into ownership in minor league baseball.
Right.
I have very little desire to work at the major league level.
Okay.
That's really all about wins and losses for the most part. What we do, as I said earlier, is about memories and communities.
Right.
So I want to get into the ownership level, whether that's here, whether it's in another community, I don't know.
Sure.
And if, you know, if that works out or doesn't work out, maybe at a national, you know, organization. Sure. From a minor league baseball governance perspective, you know, maybe there's a job somewhere for me down in St. Pete one day, because I think that, you know, minor league baseball draws 41 plus million fans.
Wow.
10 straight years. There's only one sport that outdraws us.
Yeah.
That's major league baseball. Minor league baseball outdraws the NFL and NBA combined. So, you know, it's just, it's a great sport, and I I'm very fortunate to be able to work in it.
And we're fortunate to have you here. And if there was one thing that you'd like everybody to get out of the time that we spent together, one of those memories, what would it be for all our viewers?
From our time together?
Yes.
Be passionate.
Okay.
Be passionate about what you do. And, you know, and be fearless in finding what your passion is. Sometimes we don't go far enough down the road to find that passion.
Right.
And make sure you open up enough doors.
Well, there's no question about it. Marty has found the passion. What Marty and each and every one of us need to do is learn what he has just taught us. He taught us about culture. He taught us about leadership. He taught us about, it's not about him, it's about making other people happy. He taught us about himself and what his future goals are, and frankly, how he's going to get there. And I do use the word taught, because this is a learning experience for each and every one of us. That's why we bring these caliber-styled guests to your Omaha High with Andy Greenberg. One of the things you have to remember and ask yourself is, what are you going to do with this information? Are you going to take it, replay it, and then do more work for yourself? Absolutely. Marty says, work hard, work strong, keep the vision always in mind. Marty, thank you so much for inspiring each and every one of us.
Andy.
Continued success. We don't want you to leave Omaha, and we want you to take that magic and just bring it everywhere where you can. So this week on your Omaha High with Andy Greenberg, you learned about leadership, watches, baseball stadiums, yellow highlight, and of course, satisfaction, which means taking enough action. By this point in the show, you should start feeling good about yourself. You should start feeling good about the city of Omaha. You should start feeling good about Impact One. And of course, next week, you get to return back to your Omaha High with Andy Greenberg to learn more vignettes, meet another interesting guest. And the only thing I would ask over this time period is to stay high on yourself, stay high on the city of Omaha, and come back again next week to your Omaha High with Andy Greenberg. See you then. Your Omaha High was sponsored by Best Buy Signs, creator of the Omaha Parks Program, OmahaFastFoods.com, Kohl's Pharmacy and Home Care, Certified Transmission, Centris Federal Credit Union, Shouldit, Rotella's Italian Bakery, La Peeps Restaurant, Performance Auto Group, Two Men and a Truck, Crane Landscape Construction, Shout Weekly, Mid-America Speakers Bureau, Farm Bureau Financial Services, Critter Control.